Hey Siri, it's showtime.
It doesn't look like you have an app named Showtime.
No, you idiot. We got a show to do.
Okay, do not disturb is now on.
Whoa, that's loud.
I'll dial it down.
Thanks, mate. Play some music.
Now playing your liked songs.
G'day. My name's Davo. I'm part of the Tertiary Employment Education Training Work for the Dole program. Let's keep the roadies on the road. Now, before the show starts, I'd just like to acknowledge this latecomer. In you come. Also, I would like to acknowledge that we're on the traditional country of the Bundjalung people, and they've been telling stories and singing songs and dancing right here for thousands of years. And that is what the Daves are going to come out and do tonight. Oh, now I'd also like to acknowledge and pay my deep respect, in fact, my admiration, for any Daves we have in the audience. Do we have any Daves in the house tonight? Yes. G'day, Dave. If the show goes well, we'll have a few Dave beers after the show. Okay. All right. So without any further ado, let's kick this show in the guts and we'll start her up. I'll just see if the actors are ready. One sec. How are we going backstage? Were you ready yet?
Not quite yet, mate.
Now this is pretty much not just a solo show. We've got lights and sound, and we've got Dangerous Dave doing the sound. If we can also, g'day Dangerous Dave. G'day. He's behind you, that's all right, doesn't matter. And we've also got Deefa doing lights. Deefa's from a little town called Werrunderaduna, and that's just past fuck all. How are you, Deefa? You can just show us what you got with your lights, just do a bit of flashing or something, and look at that. Imagine what Deefa could do with a big stadium lighting rig. Be amazing. Now, in case of emergency, it is my actual delectable delight and my tremendous thrill and my palpable pleasure to just run through a few housekeeping items with you before the show starts. That's all right. So everyone's got their phone off. That's a pretty easy one. I've done that one. Now, if you need the toilets or if you need the bar, it was outside in the courtyard. Now, if you need the toilets, you go up the stairs and just to your left. The toilets are for binaries and non-binaries and just for anyone who needs a piss. Now, in case of emergency, such as a snake in the venue or someone has a hemorrhoid burst, which has happened, then you're going to need to see... What's your name?
Alex.
Alex? You're going to need to see Alex. Case of emergency, she's wrapped. She's wrapped. She was in the second row and she's getting talked to by the actor. But no, so just... Have you had experience with hemorrhoids, Alex?
Not personally.
No, you haven't. Well, tonight could be your lucky night. You never know. It's going to be awesome. All right, well, let's just see if we're just about... You guys ready to... Yep. Okay. Let's do this like a Buddhist. Gives me great pleasure to introduce to you the star of the show. He's incredibly talented. He's very handsome. He's available and single, and he told me to say that himself. Would you please make welcome to the stage, Uncle David! The ancient flames of Thespis are now alight, and the spirit of Dionysus rests within each one of us tonight. Greetings and salutations, Byron Bay. You might be able to tell by my haircut that I'm actually a professional actor.
Now, what that means is my voice and my body is totally in tune with itself. Every single muscle and sinew available to me at a simple command, like so. Thank you very much. Thank you. Didn't mean to scare anyone in the front row. Now, I'm a trained actor. I've trained myself, actually, at the Uncle David Academy of Dramatic Art. There I studied many things, from Shakespeare to Gorky to Chekhov, Pissov, Suck Me Off, all the big ones in the world of theatre, as well as, of course, movement and voice! 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 Thank you very much. Thank you. Now, we're gathered here tonight in Byron Bay Theatre to watch my nephew David's mental health show. Mental health and my nephew. I mean, he talks about resilience and mindfulness all the time, and I guess the poor bugger has to because he's a few roos short in the top paddock. You know what I'm saying? He's a bit fucked in the noodle box sometimes. But I'm actually not here to disrespect my nephew. No, I'm here to support him and appreciate him because he's had a bit of a hard time, and his mum's asked me to look after him because his mum knows that he can be a real dickhead. So to all of us gathered here today in this holy theatrical space, to have a shared human experience, heart to heart, mind to mind, would you please make somewhere inside your beautiful hearts to make welcome to the stage my nephew, the dickhead. So this new show, what's it going to be about? Well, it can't be about hitchhiking because I've already made that show. But it could still be about a journey. Yeah, an inner journey. My journey. And I had an acoustic guitar last time, but this time I'll bring some electric guitars and I'll pull them over there and I'll put the lights on them and then I'll have a backdrop here and that'll look cool. And then the audience, I'll put them, I'll put them right here. Ah, they look beautiful. I'll just try and connect and look in their eyes and breathe. Be authentic. And I'll stand right in the center of the stage. I'll stand right in the center of the stage and I'll say something to them like, let me tell you a story. This is a story about a bloke called Dave who sometimes gets depressed. Now, the first time I got depressed, I was studying acting at the Victorian College of the Arts, the VCA. I was 20 years old and I was now in third year, the final year. At the end of the course, you get your little 2 or 3 minutes and you perform to an industry audience. And it's called Agent's Day. It's a really stressful thing. Everyone says how horrible it is because the audience is all film directors and theatre producers and writers and casting agents and acting agents. That's exactly right. That was my reaction too. I just wanted to cry. So at the beginning of the year, though, I felt fine. It was a long way away. But then I noticed that my, hair's falling out. But I dealt with it. I dealt with it the way most blokes and my friends were dealing with stuff back then. Yeah, you go, mate, you go. Fuck, I love you, mate. I love you, mate. Hey, 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 Brownie, Mapsy, go. Hey, how's the boys, eh? We're just the boys.
I'm so glad I think young men are much more mature than what I ever was. Anyway, it's 8 weeks out from Agent's Day, and we're doing our final play. It's called Cymbeline by William Shakespeare. And I got cast as a bloke called Cloten. Now, Cloten is arrogant, he's a fool, he's a fop, he's full of hubris, and halfway through the play, he gets his head chopped off. But in the beginning, he's got some cool lines, and I'm getting to sword fight. And I'm fighting with another student, Adam. Note, Adam is not his real name for privacy reasons. Anyway, so I'm fighting Adam Bartlett. And I get to say my lines. Die the death when I have slain thee with my proper hand. I'll follow those that even now fled hence, and on the gates of London town set your heads. And I felt this hate, and I felt this violence, and I went over to the director and I said, mate, I really feel like I could kill him. And he said, that's great. Oh, that's wonderful acting. But I wasn't acting. I didn't know who I was. Everyone was looking at me. And I just, psst, David, what's going on out there? It's all right, Uncle David, I just, it don't sound all right from backstage, mate. I think you better come off. I was just, Uncle David, I just, get off stage. Sorry, it's all right, mate, it's all right. Grab yourself a drink, maybe take one of your pills, hey? Why don't you try a harden the fuck up pill? It's pretty obvious that I'm gonna go out and have to rescue the show, mate. That's what I'm here for. We don't want to be losing them. Okay, I don't think we're losing them yet. All right, I'll go out. Some music, please, Deefa. Missed me? I missed you guys. Every single one of you. You're all beautiful. You're beautiful people. On the inside, but more importantly, where it counts, on the outside. Like I can tell you're beautiful, and you're, Jesus fucking Christ, what happened to your faith? No, I'm only joking, mate. You are the most beautiful. Apologies for my nephew. He can be a bit of a downer, you see. Poor bugger, he spent years and years in therapy, spending thousands and thousands of dollars. I mean, he's tried all the talking therapies as well as hypnotisms, crystals, shaman pulling invisible shit out of his body. He's tried Jesus, Buddha, Allah, men's group, somatic body works, neuropsychopharmacology, pills, and even more pills, including antidepressants, mood stabilizers, augmentation agents, anti-anxiety meds, and just recently, lisdexamfetamine, which some of you might know is legal speed. Does anyone know that that's legal speed? Well, lisdexamfetamine. So if you want some of that after the show, I can sort you out. All right. Now, David has even made it into the top nut house in Melbourne. The number one psychiatric hospital in Melbourne, the Melbourne Clinic. And there he saw the biological psychiatrist, Dr. Carlos Jorge. And Dr. Carlos Jorge told him in no uncertain terms that his brain was broken, suggested electroshock therapy, and at the end of each session said, why don't you just wear the yellow Brazilian soccer shirt? Anyway, let's get the young fella back out here for another crack at the big time. So what I'd invite you to do is just to gently get your hands and just rub them together. Just do a little bit of self-care. Feels good, doesn't it? Just get into that little muscle there. That's a little ripper. And if you're not freaking out about COVID now, I just want you to stretch out. Stretch out and connect with another hand in the space. Can you feel the namaste, the energy, the love? Can you feel that kundalini rising? Well, let's put all that energy and get the young fella back out here for another crack. Out you come, David! Thanks, Uncle David. I don't know here if people have experienced depression either firsthand with themselves or through a family member or a friend, but when you're in that deep, dark hole, you can't think,
you can't feel, and sometimes you can't even cry. And your mind, you're spinning out monkey mind. It's a mind that criticizes and judges all the time. I wish I could turn this judge off just to feel all right, to feel okay. I wish I could turn this judge off and I'd hold myself in a different way. This is a song about turning off that whole itty shitty bitty committee and riding like a cowboy, free, off into the sunset. Just seems to be this way. I'm wired tonight, you know. It just seems to be this way. I'm wired tonight, you know. Byron Bay. Hills till we're out of sight. I say, come on, cowboy, won't you ride through this night? I say to these hills till we're out of sight. I say, come on, cowboy, won't you ride through this night? I say to these hills till we're out of sight. I say, come on, cowboy, won't you ride through this night? I say to these hills till we're out of sight. I could turn this judge off. I would send them away on a beach holiday. And if I could turn this judge off, I would hold myself in a different way. But it just seems to be this way. I'm wired tonight, you know. Tonight, you know. It just seems to be this way. I'm wired tonight, you know. Byron Bay. I say, come on, cowboy, won't you ride through this night? I say to these hills till we're out of sight. I say, come on, cowboy, won't you ride through this night? I say to these hills till we're out of sight. I say, come on, cowboy, won't you ride through this night? I say to these hills till we're out of sight.
Thank you. Thanks. When I was writing this show, I just wanted to put heaps and heaps of Daves in it. I wanted to have the Festival of the Dave. More Daves in this show than any other show in the history of theatre. And for a while, I had heaps of them in here. I had Byron Bay life coach, David. Hi. Welcome to my seminar. It's great to be here. My name is David Eagle Rising, 747 Dreamliner, but you can call me Crystal Uluru. I will heal you with my sacred BSB and my magical mystical account numbers. I had Stoner Doverday.
Man, this is the best marijuana I've had since this morning. And I got it from Brunswick Heads Pharmacy. They don't call it Brunswick Heads for nothing. And you know what? It's medicinal marijuana, so it doesn't affect your brain.
I also had Scottish Union rep Davey. Hore, pal, you could fall down the toilet and you'd come up smelling of roses, mate. And I had Bitcoin trillionaire Daveology. People, 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 beep. Ah, I just made $700 million. What's your hourly rate? But there was too many Daves in my head. They're indelibly printing themselves upon my psyche. Too many Daves in the house. Too many Daves in the house. Who let the Daves out? Who let the Daves out? Dave let the Daves out. Dave let the Daves out. I love acting. I love the fun and pretending to be someone else. I love it how good art can help you move through the big feelings. You know, it doesn't matter if it's whatever, music, art, dance, writing, literature, stories, photography, films, anything. Sometimes you just got to get those big feelings out, you know. You got to sing like no one can hear you and dance like no one can see you and love like you've never been hurt before and express yourself. Shit, DJ! Motherfucking Ray Dave on the microphone here. I'm a freaking nut, like a macadamia. Got subwoofers in the Macca's car park. Built this rave in the middle of the dark. Jack my beats and download my shit. Lick my ice cream, it's banana split. I got more merch than a shelter workshop. But my mum helps me when my new tunes drop. Cause I'm Rave Dave. Cause I'm Rave Dave. I'm Rave Dave. When I say rave, you say Dave. Rave, rave. When I say hip, you say hop. Hip, hip. Taking hits from the bong. Taking hits from the bong. The boy needs therapy. In a word, he's a nut. He's crazy in the coconut. And melatonin hit me for my serotonin. Diagnose me, overdose me. Let God tell me it's supposed to be PTSD, ADHD. Oh my, FG and mood disorder. Cops gonna shoot me for law and order. Woo! Woo! Alright, stop the music! Stop the music! Hey, 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 hey! Hey! My name is Senior Sergeant Constable White. Now, Constable Gary, over here we have a situation. We have a situation that could get critical. All right. Ooh. Well, you all saw that guy. He was coming at me with a plastic fork. That was self-defense. Hit it, DJ! Bipolarity, maybe there's a better me. Zap my brain with electrotherapy. Schizophrenic, give me anesthetic. Punch me in the head, I think I'm Jeff Fanning. Neurodiverse, anxiety, depression. A mofo just trying to be expressing. I say rave, you say Dave. Rave, rave. And I say hip, you say hop. Hip, hip. Peace out, motherfuckers, peace out. Have a great night out, rave Dave out, yo. After that first depression, when it happened, I was living in Melbourne in a share house in North Fitzroy. And in that house, there was a really crazy puppy dog, real puppy brain. But the dog was like, it should have been older to know better. So I don't know how old it was, but it still had a puppy brain. And I'm in my room and I'm just spinning out. I hadn't slept for 4 days and four nights. And I was so wired. Suddenly the dog burst into my room. It jumps with its muddy feet up on the bed, and I picked it up and I grabbed it and I was going to throw it against the wall. But I didn't. I just put the dog down and then I burst into tears. I went from the school counselor to the psychologist to the psychiatrist. I don't know here if anyone's been to a psychiatrist before, but The first time you see one, it's pretty weird. Well, this guy met me at the door.
David, 20 years old. You're not feeling too good, hey? Please, come in. Come in. Come in.
Walked into these guys' rooms and they just looked so expensive. There was artwork everywhere and I looked around for the couch thing for me to lie on and, oh, he didn't even have one of those. He had these big, beautiful burgundy chairs. There he had a nice one. Over here he had a big, beautiful burgundy three-seater. I thought I'd sit down here. That felt a bit uncomfortable. So I didn't stay there. Wow, he had these amazing artwork on the walls. Over here he had a painting. Can you stand up, please? Yeah, and the painting had gold frames around the painting. Yeah, and the painting just looked really happy. It was all these paintings of portraits. That's really good. Look, can I borrow you? Oh, no, stay there. You've got a beautiful painting. This painting had gold frames as well around it, and this painting was really sad. Really, really, really sad. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. Out you come, mate. Out you come. You're finding it pretty funny for everyone else, aren't you? All right, so you got your gold frames. And now this one, happy, sad. This one was like happy and sad, but happy and a bit confused. And that's really good, mate. You should do something with your acting. That's really good. Okay, you can sit down again. Thanks, guys. So it was expensive. That's what I'm saying. Over here, there was a vintage desk, beautiful wood with a red leather top. And on top of that leather, there was a porcelain lamp. And the lamp was of a sad, bald clown with makeup running down its face. And it was holding up a red balloon, which was the actual lamp. I couldn't take my eyes off this sad, bald clown. And I was going to talk to the psychiatrist about my baldness. And he was also bald. I didn't want to trigger him. Anyway, he looked at me through these really thin, gold-rimmed glasses and he said something to me like,
Yes, it appears quite obvious to me that you have a subjective sense of the superego in conflict with the upper ear section of the hippocampus, which is clearly in a state of fight or flight or personal sameness, which is reflected as a quality of the unconscious self in a crisis of self-image.
I left. I said thanks. But really on the inside I'm thinking, how long would it take me to walk over there and just headbutt him right in the face? But it didn't. Instead, I heard this really feeble, depressed voice say, thanks for your time. It's $480 an hour. What a scammer. Yeah, you take care of yourself too, mate. Thanks. Thanks for nothing. In the belly of the The next song I'm going to play is a song about waiting. It's about waiting to come out of a depression. It's about waiting to feel good again. It's about waiting for change. It's about waiting for something in your life to happen and feel good.
Inside your head, and there's a world of dread, and you can't help but touch the dead. that dog comes, there's blood on his teeth. He wants someone, and you want to move, but you cannot run. And Pumania, wipe away my tears, and hold on my fear while I'm waiting here. When you see that door, you're down for the count, you're on that floor. You wish for more. When a circle of thoughts, they scream, this unwanted thing like some horror dream. And you try your best not to be seen.
Deef, is that the same mic we used earlier? Because it doesn't sound as good as what it sounded before. No, I don't think that's my microphone, to be honest. It's not my microphone. Sorry, it's not my microphone, I'm sorry. David, what the hell's going on now? It's not my microphone.
Yeah, it is, mate. I checked it myself. It's definitely your microphone.
Davo, go and check it.
But it's his microphone.
Go and do your job.
Huh, all right.
Yep, it's got his name on it. Fucking his microphone. I told you it was his microphone. Check it properly. Do test. Testies. That was just a little joke for Dave. Testicles. Bit of a joke for half the audience. 1, 2. 1, 2. That's a joke for everyone.
No. Look, it's his microphone. It's totally fine. Yeah, okay.
Did you tell him about the toilet situation, Davo?
Look, about the toilet situation, I don't know how many drinks you've had. Maybe a few. But, look, if you are busting for the toilet, it's a little bit awkward because you're going to have to go up there and it's dark. We have to put lights on. And so, look, management suggests that if you're busting to go, that you don't. You just hold on to it. And you can hold on to it with a bit of help from your imagination. So you just put yourself mind's eye down here into your ovaries or your testicles, and then you've got a tube, and you just suck it up. You just go... And then you get your other tube and you suck that sucker up. Just watch the show like that. Just enjoy your night out. Nah, only joke. Look, we're all adults, except for the kid. If you do need your toilet, then just help yourself. Go to the toilet. But just know this, depending on which Dave is on stage, they may want to have a little chat to you. Could get a little bit awkward. If you push past that awkwardness, good for you. When you go to the toilet, when you come back, there's a new Dave on stage.
That Dave's going to want to have a chat to you. If you push past that and you go to your seat, and depending on how long you've taken, the audience is going to be thinking, hey, did they just do a number one? That was a while. Maybe they did a number two. It's just food for thought. That's all I'm saying. Hey, don't shoot the messenger. Job done. Job done, Dave. Uncle David.
Well done, Davo. Okay. All right, David. Out you go, mate. Let's finish the show.
Uncle David, I just feel sick. I can't do this.
Yes, you can, mate.
Uncle David, I can't.
All right, I'll tell you what. I'll go and rescue the show again, and you stay here and get your shit together. Deefa, could I please have some music, my man?
The guitar. I didn't see it there before.
Wow. Now, David was really panicking about his show. Shitting himself, actually. And his mum asked me to take him out because she knows he can get anxious and one thing can lead to another. But anyway, if you ever... She asked me to take him out for one drink. Has anyone ever had a friend say that to them? Let's just pop out for one. Well, David and I, we just popped out for one drink. And then we had another one. And I guess you could say we were getting a little bit tipsy. Two blokes, an uncle and a nephew, just talking. Well, we had a few more drinks and a few shooters and a couple of bottles after that and a slab, and I guess you could say we were getting absolutely fucking maggoted. And David got this strange look in his eye and he reached out across the table and he picked up my hands and he said, Uncle David, all the world's your prawn. Exactly. And I looked at this bloke with his big heart and his bloodshot eyes, and I said, oyster. All the world's my oyster. You fucking moron. But this song's dedicated to David and people out there like him who believe that someday, in some way, the world truly will be their prawn. It goes like this. Sometimes that world is your prawn. Sometimes that world is your prawn. Like the big red and white stripy one at Ballina. So good to see that renovated. I bet that makes the people of Ballina rapt. Put their town back on the map. Sometimes that world is your prawn. But there's plenty of other things in that sea. Like jelly blubbers and blue bottles. And things that look really fucking weird. And tiny stuff called plankton that makes the whale so huge. Sometimes that world is your prawn. Okay, I'll tell you what we're going to do, Byron. We're going to have a bit of a group sing-along now. It's amazing, you sing this song with total strangers and before you know it, you've had a good family Christmas. Sometimes the world is your prawn. Very easy. Here we go. Sometimes that world is your prawn. A little bit louder. Let's work the abdomen.
Sometimes that world is your prawn. That's good. Let's really go for it. Now you've got it. Sometimes that world is your prawn.
Add a harmony if you can.
Sometimes that world is your prawn.
Beautiful, on your own now, take it away.
Sometimes that world is your prawn.
Beautiful, one more time.
Yeah,
that'll do.
you're giving me a woody. Sometimes that word is your pro. Thank you.
Okay, David.
I've got a meeting out of the hands of my palms, or the palms of my hands, as they say in showbiz.
Fuck that line up.
See, what I was meant to say was I've got a meeting out of the palms of my hands, and I said palms of my hands instead of hands of my palms. It's good not to go into the details. No one cares.
David, I've still...
Hey, I've still got them. Out you come, mate. Let's finish the show. David. Mate, let's come and finish the show. David, you've got the same last name. You're a Houston. Now get out of here. David, fucking man up. Sorry. Lost my temper. You see, I'm a bit of a, I'm an older kind of bloke. It's emotions when I love golf. No, I do. I love golf. And David, perhaps if you loved golf as well, we could love golf together. Do you know what I'm saying, mate? Get up off the ground. Come on. Uncle David, let go of me. Let go of me. Come out from behind the chair. Come out. You're going to go and finish this show. Uncle David, I can't do it. Get out there. Get. I got diagnosed with depression when I was 20 years old. After a few more episodes and a few more years, it got updated to a major recurrent depressive disorder. When I get depressed, I withdraw. I can't work, I can't study, I can't be around colleagues, I can't live in a share house, and I have to move home to live with my folks. Well, one time I was living with my family, and I thought I was on my own, and I'm just lying on the floor crying in this room where I was staying, and I heard a little knock at the door. It was my mum. And mum came in, she didn't say anything. She just lay down on the ground next to me and she put her hand on my heart. If it wasn't for my family, I know I'd be dead. They were worried about me, my brothers, my sister, my mum, dad, the counsellor, the psychiatrist, the psychologist, and they all wanted me to go on the disability support pension. I didn't want that, but the truth was that I couldn't work for years at a time. So a plan got hatched from the psychiatrist I was seeing, Dr. Chris Walsh, and he had to write a letter to Centrelink. And he wrote, from October 2013 to October of 2019, Dave still suffered from significant symptoms of depression most of the time. He had low mood, anhedonia, which is the inability to feel pleasure, poor concentration, low motivation, and thoughts beset with themes of helplessness, hopelessness, and suicide. And that was me. Further, Dave has significant moments of time where his conversation, thoughts, and behaviour are seriously disturbed. The favourite way that GPs and doctors deal with depression is through medication. Medication from Big Pharma. Big Pharma, who makes trillions and trillions of dollars of poor, vulnerable people. These are the Big Pharma meds I've been on since being messed up. Antidepressants, including duloxetine, agomelatine, venlafaxine, vortioxetine, sertraline, escitalopram, and punch me in the headatine. But they've all got sexy names with their Zs and their Vs and their Xs, like Effexor and Zoloft and Lexapro, which is for professional nut jobs. We've got Luvox for lovers. Brazella for people from Brisbane. And one I've never been on before, it's called Vibrid, and they spell it V-I-I-B-R-Y-D. Hey, have you lost your edge for life?
If you lost your vibe and you want to get it back, take Vibrant. Hey, it's for winners. I've also been on various augmentation agents or mood stabilizers. Some of these include sodium valproate, carbamazepine, lithium, lamotrigine, and recently, listexamphetamine. Now, I heard my Uncle David say that if you wanted to get some listexamphetamine to see him off backstage, you can't actually do that for two reasons. The first reason is it's highly illegal, but I don't actually care about that. But the main reason, which I do care about, is you can't see him because he's not actually real. He's in here, there's no one there. Just me. Just me, there's no one out there. Pretty sure, yeah. Now, I love music, and I love punk, and I love the whole ethos of punk music that says, fuck the world, let's change it. And it seems now more than ever we need to start changing some things up. But it's my dream to one day play at the Big Pharma Christmas party. And I'd check out all the executives. And I'd say, I've got a song for you. And this song is called Fuck You, Big Pharma! Hey, Big Pharma, what you got cooking for me? Hey, Big Pharma, what are you making me? Hey, Big Pharma, what are you selling me? Hey, Big Pharma, what you killing me? Every little thing you monetize, fake drug studies and fake drug lies. Every little thing you monetize, I see you lying in Satan's eyes. Pills for this and pills for that, medical journal bullshit stats. Pills for this and pills for that, it's blood money for fat, fat cats. Cause it's a rip, rip off, rip, rip off, everyone. Rip, rip off, rip, rip off, louder. Rip, rip off, fuck, 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 fuck off. Have you ever been in love? Anyone ever been in love?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like crazy, madly, totally head over heels, totally oxytocinated in love. And I love love because it's kind of like the opposite of depression, you know. You're connected to someone, you're not alone, and somehow through that exchange you're connected to yourself and you're connected to nature and everything around you, and you can't stop touching each other and kissing and just being in love. Oh, it's amazing. Well, it happened to me, 4th of December 2011, I got to play the greatest acting role ever created. This is a role that's more complicated than Hamlet. It's more lyrical than King Lear. It's more badass and villainous than Darth Vader. I got to play Collingwood AFL football legend, the Macedonian marvel, Peter Dacos. Now, it wasn't Peter Dacos that I fell in love with, but I could have. But it's because of Peter Dacos that my life changed forever. You see, I got this gig and they gave me this jumper, and I was pretty happy with that because these are about 180 bucks. And Collingwood had got too big for their football suburban ground. So they moved to the MCG, which holds 100,000 people. And at the MCG, there's the big games. And meanwhile, back at their suburban ground, they wanted to turn it into a community centre. So they knocked the walls down, they got it open, they got a bunch of community organisations to be there, and they'd planned the biggest day. Heaps of bands, indigenous mob, multi-culti food, it was going to be a huge event. And I got cast as Peter Dacos, and they wanted me to start the whole thing off. Now, Peter Dacos, he had a magnificent mullet. It wasn't this one, he had real hair. And it was a different colour. But the costume budget blew out, so this is the one we've got. They also gave me a gold-painted football. And it was my job to start this gig off. I had 15 belly dancers around me in their traditional costumes, and they were shaking and shimmering as they walked. And we walked right out to the middle of the ground. Right in the center circle, there was a podium. I stood up on the podium on this ground that I'd seen so many amazing footy games at.
I held the football aloft in the sunlight and it sparkled, and the siren rang three times. Burn, burn, burn. I handballed the footy high into the sky. At that exact moment, the crowd and the game erupted into colour and movement. Dancers were running from everywhere. Didgers droned, bagpipes played, calisthenic dancers were cartwheeling, break dancers were breakdancing, boot scooting were boot scooting, line dancers, everyone. Oh, these African dancers were shaking their booty. What a gig. Wow. And straight after the gig, there was this girl that came up to me, and I'd met her just before at rehearsals, like 3 days earlier, but just for a few minutes. And she asked me if I wanted to go out. Not only that, she said, do you want to go camping with me? And I tried to play it really cool and went, oh, camping? Yes, please. Don't change your mind. So anyway, we went camping. And she went down to the campsite before. And she'd had the esky set up. She had the tent, the fairy lights. She had a fire all ready to go. Just had to put a match on it. And the campground was beautiful. It was all grass. There was no prickles anywhere. And there was a river that flowed all the way around the campsite. So we walked on the sandy beach and we walked upstream for a while, just chatting and talking. We took all our clothes off and just floated naked down the river in the beautiful sunset. We got out on these warm rocks. And as the sun was setting on one side, a full moon was coming up on the hill. And William Shakespeare couldn't have written this any better. Because we got closer and closer and closer until we kissed. Bam! That was it for me. I was signed up. I was in. This was going to be awesome. Yeah, she was the most amazing person. We were going to date for a while. Then we were going to get a house. We were going to bump out a kid, get a dog, have another kid, and just live the suburban dream. Well, about 6 months later, we're driving to Darwin. We're in between Alice Springs and Darwin. And part of the going out process, she'd asked me not to contact an old girlfriend who was a counsellor, and she'd been helping me a lot. And I said, okay. So I rang my friend and I said, sorry, I can't be friends with you. I kind of heard her heart break on the phone. And I went away and I was on this road trip. I was coming out of a bit of a depression and I wanted to let my friend know, hey, I'm okay, I'm not going to top myself, thank you. Sorry, I can't be friends, this is a crazy situation. Anyway, we stopped the van and taking the dog out. And I come back and she's holding up this note that I've written. And she's screaming at me and she's throwing things at me. And I'm walking away on the red desert sand and I'm just thinking, ah, this is just definitely not the person for me. My suburban dream was dead. My mate at drama school, he wrote a song called Suburbia.
Valium to keep the facade. TV shopping and midday soaps, they're just a remedy to keep up the hope. 6 o'clock, dinner's on the table. The old man would run if he was able. Behind the sun he hides his face, checking for winners in the last race. In suburbia, there's lots of trees. In suburbia, there's lots of peace. I'm just praying for my folks to die, so I can have my bigger piece of this pie. In suburbia. My mate who wrote this song, he's not here anymore. He
He tried to take his life from poisoning himself inside a car with exhaust fumes. Someone found him and rescued him. 1 week later, he jumped in front of a train. I don't blame anyone who takes their life. It's a tough gig sometimes. And I know I've been one of the lucky ones. So far, I've always come back from that side. And I wish my mate could have come back. He's missed out on so much. At drama school, while I was heading into that first depression, we had to make some solo work. And I'm sitting alone in this studio and my mind's spinning out. And it's got rafters. It's an old warehouse. And clear as day, I look up to the rafter and I can see it there, hanging. My own body dangling from a noose. After that breakup that I told you about, it took me a long time to get better. A few years. Because every time I get depressed, I lose all my confidence. It's not like a broken leg, you know, you can't just wrap it in plaster or a bandage. And you can't see it. No one can see it. And you become an expert at hiding it. You hide it from colleagues, from friends, and for some people, even from family, until it's too late. Suicide. So hard to talk about. Do you know suicide is the biggest killer in Australia for people aged 15 to 44 years old? For our young people, they're more likely to take their own life than they are die in a car accident. For Indigenous brothers and sisters, the rates are twice as high. And every day in Australia, 9 people take their life. So while you've been watching the show and I've been doing it and you've been getting here, somewhere in Australia, someone is just about to check out. I was wondering how to finish the show, and it's such a cliche, but everyone says, reach out. Reach out if you're depressed. But it is so hard to do when you're in that state. Connection is everything, you know. You'd be kind to your mate if they were having a roughie. Why is it so hard to be kind to ourselves? And if it's the other way and you know someone's struggling, then check in. Don't be afraid to have a mental health conversation. We're all here and we're all the same and we all just want to have a happy life. One thing I was going to do with this show is I was going to put sand everywhere. That was going to be my set. And I'd have the sand around the esky, and when I talked about the girl at the beach, I'd have the sand there. And during this part, I'd get a broom and I'd just shape the sand. And I'd make the sand into a big, beautiful love heart. And then I'd invite anyone who'd lost someone to suicide or for whatever cause of death. If you wanted to, you could come and light a candle and put it in the love heart of sand. But you can't have real candles in the theatre anymore. And the sand would just go everywhere. But from a $2 bargain shop, I do have these. These beautiful plastic kitsch candles. And I've got an altar. Got a sacred Aussie altar. The esky. It's got lights in it. It's got flowers in it. The kind of flowers that you see on the sides of the road. So yeah, I'm just going to play the final song. And you're more than welcome to come and put a candle on the esky. That one. Thanks for coming. Thanks for an amazing night. And take care on this beautiful, this scary, and this sometimes super fun roller coaster of life. I wrote this song in my 20s after that first big episode. Thank you.
see the stars fall from the sky tonight. Watch as they all come crashing down. There's a starless sky tonight. Down, bring out that little star, throw it to the sky, throw it afar. It might just hang there like the way for you, for others too, in their blue.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Dangerous Dave, we have on Lights and Sound and D-Fast. Thank you, guys. Thank you for coming. I'm available for children's birthday shows too. We're going to have a bit of an interval. We'd love you to come back to be part of a mental health forum. We've got some amazing health facilitators to chat about different things. I know it's Friday night if you do have to scoot off, but we'll have an announcement. But I'm so glad that you could all come and see this show. So have a great night and thanks so much.